Welcome to the 8th annual Media Studies Showcase. This event is really about sampling or showing off some of the student work in the program. You realize the program has concentrations in radio and television production, journalism, film studies, we have course tracks in public relations and theater. And so you might not know about all those things. And what the showcase is about is showing students work throughout the program. So maybe you might be able to, you might be interested in taking a course in another concentration within the program. It can still count towards your major, because you can take up to 12 credits outside your concentration within the major of media studies. Okay? And if you're not a media studies major, you're considering maybe taking a few courses in media studies, well, you can do that as open electives, or you can even minor in media studies if you'd like to do that. That's about 5 courses over the 120 level. Anyway, I'm just going to show sample work. We have professors from various classes here. Very happy that they're able to show up. But basically, it's about the student work. Also, I'd like to point out our Dean of the School of the Arts, Dr. Tamara Jashy, is here. Please give a wave. The college divided up into schools, and the Media Studies program is in the Department of Communication and the Arts, the Department of Communication and the Arts, and the School of Liberal Arts. And that's how that whole thing works there. So up first, we have, incidentally, the food is open throughout the afternoon. Just please, when you get up and get the food, just be really quiet so you're not to disturb what's going on in front of the room. Make sure your cell phones are put on vibrate so it doesn't ring during the performance. We appreciate your cooperation. Up next, a journalist, Professor Michael Parada, heads the Impact newspaper. Also, luckily for us, Professor Michael Parada is also been elected as the chair of the Department of Communication and the Arts. He's going to talk to us about the impact and about our first topic, life after being wrongfully convicted. Please welcome Professor Michael Parada.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for coming. Glad to have you here on this rainy day. What's great about this event is you get to see a sample of all the different slices of media. And right now, you may have in your mind that I am going to be a radio jockey. I want to play radio. And some of you might be saying, I am involved in corporate communications. I want to work on big political campaigns. And some of you might be saying, I feel comfortable behind the camera. And that's all great. But as your knowledge of the media grows, as your career grows, you're going to realize that you need to be exposed to as much avenues in the media as you possibly can. And the way everything is being digitized, the way everything is being condensed, in 10 years, you may be asked to go to an event, you may be asked to interview people and get audio clips, you may be asked to write 600 to 700 words, you may be asked to shoot video, and then you might be asked to package it all together and handle all aspects of the media. And why do I say you may have to do that? Because I'm lying to you. That's what you essentially have to do right now as a journalist or in the media. And you might say, well, I have no interest in being in the media. I'm going to work public relations. Well, when you go out with a client, you need to be responsible for audio clips. You need to be responsible for video clips. You need to write their press releases. You need to know a little bit how to do everything. And what's even better is, once you know how one side of the hand works, you know how to deal with the other side. So when you're in the media, you know how to use public relations to your advantage and vice versa. So that's one great thing about today. We get to see a little bit of an example of how everything works. And as your career blossoms, you'll see that you might be plucking some pieces and using a little bit of everything. Now today, we're going to talk about a story that we worked on last month. This was our cover story, The Impact. And it's at theimpactnews.com, even though you all know that. You go on the website every single day, you soak it in, right?
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right, right, right. I thought so. I was pretty sure that. If you're not going to this website, you should, because not only do we have news about our college, we have news about college life, we have news about New York, and we have, you know, columns by our staff writers about everything that's going on in the world, updated daily. This was a story that we worked on last month, about Jeffrey Deskovic. Now, why are we talking about Jeffrey Deskovic here? What does he have to do with Mercy College? Well, he's a graduate of Mercy College. He's an alum. He's an alumni. So you must be very proud of him. What you don't know about him is he served 16 years in prison for rape and murder. I repeat that, 16 years for rape and murder. And then when he got out, you know where he went? The Mercy College dormitory. Oh, he was innocent. I forgot to include that. Us in the media, we always leave out those important details. I forgot to tell you that he did not do it. He was discovered to been bullied by a police department into a false confession. He was told, if you just sign this, you can go see your mother again. And when you're 16 years old and have been in interrogation for 6 to 8 hours, you do anything, I guess, to go see your mother. And he signed a piece of paper and said, can I see my mother now? And they said, not quite, put on these shackles first. And he went to prison for 16 years. Took probably 5 years after DNA evidence was already found that he was probably guilty, and that's how long the process takes. So it wasn't like they found DNA, and the next day, all of a sudden, it was like, oh, you get to walk out. It's a very long process, and it's a very fortunate process, very costly, a lot of work. Lawyers have to do work pro bono. And hence, you know, he was a member of what you might call the Innocence Project, which assists people in this situation. So here we are. He was out, and essentially he walked out the door, and they said, okay, you're free, see you later. And he said, well, I'm now 32 years old, I have no job skills, I have no job experience, I have nowhere to live. And actually, Mercy College saw the stories on Channel 12 and said, you know what, Jeff, we're going to give you a scholarship, and we're going to give you free room and board, and you can get your education here. So they did that. And Jeff, about 6, 7 years ago, graduated from Mercy College with a degree. Since then, he comes back every few years to speak to the college about his experiences, about dealing with the media, about being a part of the media. He now does, you know, he's on some shows himself. But what I really wanted to get out of this was I wanted the staff and I wanted our reporters to interview someone that had been already interviewed multiple times. Jeff Deskovic has been a national story. If you Google him, you'll see the New York Times has covered him, CBS has covered him, CNN has covered him. Anyone possible who has interviewed Jeff has interviewed Jeff. So that's not the easiest of experiences for a reporter when you're walking in to tell a story that's probably been told 50 to 100 times before. So not only were we going to have an interview with Jeff and try to come at him from some new angles, which is very difficult when you've told your story so many times, but this was our first attempt at teaming up with the video production side of the program. And after we wrote our story, we're going to show you our story online, we then kind of put our heads together and formed a video package. And that's the way news is being told now. You have to write your story, you have to photograph your story, and then you have to put 2 to 3 minutes together for video components. And that's kind of what this whole process was. This was our first attempt at it. I'd first like to introduce to you our managing editor of the newspaper, Marie Roser. Please come out, Marie. Bree, you're used to interviewing Mercy College officials, Mercy College athletes, Mercy College students that have interesting feature stories to tell. What's it like interviewing someone who was on CBS and NBC and was in prison for 16 years?
Well, first, like, I had to do all my research on because there's the same thing over and over and over. So, like, when you come in, you don't want to ask the person the same questions, like, that he's already gotten a million times. So I, like, went through and I got all the information that I already needed to know. Like, I knew what he served in prison, so I wasn't going to ask him that because that was kind of, like, obvious. That's why he's here. So I decided to, like, go about trying to look at things that haven't been covered. So, like, no one had asked him about, like, his first day out and, like, what happened in the courtroom that day and, like, just, like, little details here and there and about his family and how it affected them. Like, halfway through the interview, he actually turned to me and was like, no one's ever asked me that before. Like, and I was like, that's weird because I thought that would be, like, a normal question.
That is one of the highest compliments a reporter can have. Someone who's been interviewed multiple times over, especially for a student journalist, to someone say, you know, no one's ever asked me that before. It's one of the best feelings in the world. Well,
I lost my train of thought.
Oh, wow, sorry.
I also, like, when I go about interviewing, it feels really intimidating at first. After I do all my research, I think I freak myself out more. I'm like, oh, my God, I don't know what to actually ask. So just like, I'm just going to introduce myself sort of and make it more of a conversation, because to me, interviewing is not really about like sitting down and be like, what's this, what's this, what's this? It's like talking about to them about their life experiences so they can sit down and explain everything to you rather than just like one or two brief answers. Let them like completely tell you their whole story rather than like, I did this and I did this. It's like a conversation more than anything else.
You know, what Marie did and what I'm trying to teach reporters to do in the news reporting one and two classes are, the more comfortable you are with the topic, the more comfortable you are with yourself, the more comfortable you are having a conversation, the more comfortable your subject is going to become. And they're going to start telling you. And they're going to start saying, you know what, there's something else that I haven't told anybody. You know what, I'm going to include this. Because if you're rushing, if you're unprepared, then you have to understand how they feel on the other side. This is their life story. And they want to tell this story. And if you don't come to the table, so to speak, saying, I am all in, you don't treat this person like you're the most important person in the world, they're going to understand that. They're going to feel that. Well, the good thing that Marie did was she had said to Jeff, Jeff, I'm aware of this, I'm aware of this, I'm aware of this. We don't even need to cover that because that's gone over so much. And Jeff actually said, what a relief. What a relief. I've told that story so many times. So that's great. You get to talk about some other angles that you really haven't focused on before. So now I'm going to show you the story that we did. And what this is called is long-form journalism. This is... No, back to this. Long-form journalism. Long-form journalism is considered a piece of work. You're probably pushing at least 2,500 words. It can go up to 7, 8, even 9,000 words. Used to be a staple for the Sunday newspaper. All Sunday newspapers had long-form journalism. With the invasion of online journalism, reporters initially thought, well, we have so much space now. We can load readers with massive amounts of words, and it just didn't translate. Readers weren't reading anything online that was long, because where are you reading your online news? You're at work. You're at home on a desktop. I'm going to sit here. We kind of forgot about the leisure aspect of reading a long-form piece. You really don't want to do it sitting on a desktop. But what happened? Tablets have actually changed, and your smartphones have really changed the landscape of now how our reading happens. So now reading that long-form news can happen because now you can do it in the park, you can do it on the subway, you can do it on the bus ride, you can do it while walking. So as technology advances, we're actually going back to a more primitive form of storytelling, which is the longer story, as opposed to just quick, quick, quick. So Lauren, if you would please click that story. So you can just scroll down, life after being wrongfully convicted, and meet Jeffrey Deskovic, fought 16 years to feel the sun one more time. And we use that headline and subhead because that's one of the topics that he covers in his story. But he walked out of prison for 16 years. We asked him what's the first thing you remember. He said, I actually got to feel the sun, which we thought was an extremely powerful statement. And Marie actually based her introduction on it. So Lauren, you can just scroll down. And we set this up into chapters. So there's Jeff kind of getting out. There's Jeff being interviewed, and as we scroll down, there's Jeff right before he went up to prison. We talk about, you can pause right there. This is about Jeff's arrest, and the thing about, you know, doing an interview, you know, you could be the world's greatest wordsmith, but if you don't know how to structure a story, it really doesn't make a difference. Anyway, you know, you have great words, you don't know what to do with them. You know, you could be the world's greatest builder, you could put together 2x4s and bricks, but if you don't have an outline of what you're building, then doesn't really help you. So Marie and I really had to sit down and we had to divide this story into chapters, which really long-form journalism is. It isn't just one long story. You kind of get lost. You start slicing it up like a pizza, so to speak, and dividing and having equal shares elsewhere. And we're going to tell this story, and then we're going to tell this story. And the complication of that as a writer is instead of telling one story, you're actually telling about five stories. So you need five different introductions, five different endings, and they all have to form together. So it's essentially chapters. So that's Jeff in prison. He was praying for better news. Unfortunately, he did not get it. Please scroll down. Since that, Jeff has gotten out of prison, and he sued the state of New York. He sued certain police stations, and he was awarded $12 million.
Oh, no.
And so everybody might say, oh, my God, I'll take that. Jeff said, I'd take 16 years of my life back, $12 million, and he did. So he was awarded $12 million. And a question that Marie and I asked him that you know, we were wondering, and then he had kind of alluded to is, I said, Jeff, why are you here? You know, give me $16 million, I'm in Tahiti, you know, you're never seeing me again. And he said, I think about it all the time. He said, but I know there's other people in the jail cell like me. So Jeff pretty much spends all his days trying to figure out the people who are like him. You know, that's what he does with his money. You know, we were talking about when the Mets were making a run at the World Series, and he said, yeah, I know I have the means, but I just can't justify spending $10,000 on a World Series ticket when I could put that money into someone's legal defense. So talk about a person coming out with a heart for it. So as we scroll down, you know, Jeff, his campaign, that was actually Jeff's original interview. This is actually in Mayor Hall, believe it or not. This is where the kitchen area is now. Jeff came out full beard. So times have changed. Scroll down. That's just a little information about exoneration. That's just Jeff in his office. You know, here we talk about Jeff and his family. Another time when he had said, Jeff apparently had an uncle in law enforcement that from previous stories that we looked at, we never saw that in any story that we ever found. I mean, I just can't believe the New York Times, the Washington Post looked at the stories and never asked him, do you have any relatives in law enforcement? They didn't ask. But you know who did? The impact. And it turned out, he said, yeah, I have an uncle who's a cop. And I said, Unc's going to get me out of this. And then Unc's came back, went to the police station, said, nah, they convinced me. You did it. He said, what? He said, never heard from his uncle again. Wow. So.
And then he died while he was in prison, actually, and never got to see him be released. So
yeah.
His uncle never knew he was innocent.
So, you know, we kind of talked about that, and how he said, yeah, that hurt, to have your own family turn around, and especially a person with working knowledge of how the system works. Keep scrolling, please. So Jeff came, he lectured, that's in the journalism lab, he talked to the impact staff about dealing with a touchy subject, and that's, you know, as a reporter, I'm not going to lie to you, when something plots on your desk, you're going to be working on a murder trial, you're going to be working on a false arrest trial, you get excited, you like to do these stories during this business because you want those big stories, but we sometimes forget that there's a person that you're writing about who opens up that paper. That person has a mother and a father and maybe children and a brother or a sister. And Jeff had said for all the people, you know, the Daily News, the Post, who wrote all these stories about him in columns, you know, editorials, really blasted him. He said when it was all over and he was innocent, not one person in the media ever called him and said, Jeff, you know what? I was wrong. Congratulations. Or at least saying congratulations on your release. So realize, you know, sometimes in the media we get very hungry. And we look to scavenge pretty quick when someone's down. Realize that that's a person. You know, and that's what Jeff was kind of talking to our budding journalists about. Keep scrolling. Now this is a shame. This is the last time Jeff was here was about 3 years ago, and he brought Willie Lopez with him. Willie was the first inmate that Jeff had freed from his foundation. Willie had actually served 22 years for a very, very similar crime. And the worst part, Willie had said, was he just had a daughter right before he had went away, and his daughter never spoke to him. So he said his whole thing of getting out was to make amends with his daughter. So he was out about 6 months. He said, my daughter's first finally starting to trust me. Willie was awarded $5 million.
He was texting.
Yeah, he said, I'm texting now. What is this bizarre contraption? A week before Willie received his $5 million settlement, he died of heart. Actually, no, he died of an asthma, which he was a condition he contracted inside. And he was wrongfully convicted. So, legally, his money was in held up because the state of New York didn't want to award his family that $5 million because Willie's dead now. So why do you need this money? Fortunately, Jeff said they were able to push the money through with his wife and daughter. Given the money, but of course it's no substitute for the husband and father. And his wife, who actually stood by it, like, said his wife was the only one who believed him. Said they had a full marriage for 22 years. She stood by him the whole way. So, if you think you have relationship problems. But that was Willie. He was a real sweet man, and he passed a few months right after we met with him. So you can scroll down. So you tell us a story. Now, this is the man, Stephen Cunningham, who, when his DNA evidence came up with the person that Jeff supposedly murdered in the Bronx, Queens.
Jeff.
Okay. Okay. Where was the body found?
It was in Tarrytown.
Oh, yeah? The body was found in Tarrytown? Oh, okay.
Wasn't it found in the woods?
Possibly. When the DNA evidence popped up, they pointed to this man who was already in prison. They said, Steve, did you do it? And he's like, yeah.
But he had already killed someone else.
He had already killed somebody else. So they said, Steve, did you do this? He said, yeah, oh, yeah, that one I did. So if you're already in life prison, you could have maybe got somebody else out 15 years earlier. So that's the man who did it. We scroll down. That was one of their last nights out. These two guys karaokeing. Lily was dead a few weeks later. And that's our written story. So if you haven't read it, please log on and read it. Now, I just want to take 2 minutes. Now, we took this information, and Marie and I worked with Kareem, and we worked with Professor Grasso, and we said, now, we want to take this and make this a digital story. How can we do that? And we worked out a plan where Kareem and Professor Grasso set up the studio, brought in Jeff, and then Marie and I kind of made a game plan of what questions we were going to ask, and then after Kareem actually put together this package, so if you would please, here is our first digital news story for the Empire.
My name is Jeffrey Gessler, and I spent 16 years in prison prior to the DNA testing. For an innocent man, everyday life in prison is a battle psychologically within yourself. You have to repeatedly fight off feelings of hopelessness, helplessness, depression, thoughts of suicide pop into your mind. In many ways, you're fighting a psychological battle against yourself as much as you are against the district attorney. In addition to that, you have to avoid the obstacles, the staff, the other prisoners, the guards, all of which are obstacles to remaining focused on the clear, important goal, proving your innocence and therefore regaining your freedom. In terms of what was on my mind when my attorney told me that I was going to be getting out the next day, first I didn't believe it because the state always fought me and won. But once it finally sunk in and became real, my immediate concern was that something was going to happen between that day and the next, which was going to cause the district attorney to change your mind, and I was going to remain wrongfully imprisoned. I still remember when I walked out of the courtroom and I was free. There was a really blue sky. There wasn't a cloud in sight. And everybody who was there just started clapping because I had survived something, a really long and traumatic ordeal, and I had overcome and proved my innocence. I started a nonprofit organization called the Jeffrey Duskamp Foundation to fight wrongful convictions. I was very conscious of the fact that there were many men and women who, as a matter of fact, were left behind. We fight wrongful convictions through raising awareness, through seeking change in the law to prevent wrongful convictions. We work on freeing people who already have been wrongfully convicted. We help exonerees reintegrate back into society once they're released. Society should care about wrongfully convicted prisoners for a variety of reasons. Firstly, it could happen to them. Last year, 137 people were exonerated. According to the National Registry of Exonerations, more than 1,600 people from the early 90s forward have been wrongfully convicted. Why aren't I out on an island someplace on the beach sipping Mai Tais? Because as fun as that would be, and it is tempting, and I do have the means, the bigger moral obligation that I feel, which
where we're kind of combining the two disciplines, and I hope both sides realize that if you want to be a reporter, you have to realize that it's more about just reporting and writing. You have to learn something about technology. You have to be able to adapt. And if you're on the other side, say, I'm just going to be behind the camera, no, you can't just be. You have to know how to story tell. You have to know how to actually put together a story and tell it. So that's us for today. Thank you. Thank you.
it's called news video. I was searching online trying to figure out what was this called, and it's the term is news video. So we have news, which is print, and we have broadcast journalism, which is video, intelligent news. And now we have this, a video embedded into online news stories, and they call it news video. Up next, we have Professor J.H. Snyder. We're talking about advertising and communication studies. Now, in media studies, there's a few advertising courses and public relations courses that you can take part of your media studies degree, either radio, television, journalism, or film studies. But in addition to that, we have a separate major, not in media studies, a separate major called communication studies, which offers a full track of public, specializing in public relations, and there are other opportunities or other ideas on the shelf coming down the road, I hope. So please welcome Professor J.H. Snyder.
I'm going to talk to you about two of the courses that I teach currently, and I brought some fantastic students to share some of their work. This is Brandon Zubik and Mandy Fong. And the first class that I'd like to show some of the work from is a course that's a required course of the Comm major, and that's intercultural communication. Now, I see half of you actually have been in my class already. So for those of you who aren't, I just want to explain that intercultural communications are critical to our study of communications because, in essence, it was developed right around World War II to help our troops better adapt overseas. And so from that it evolved into, obviously, a global practice because of all the globalization and our constant need to interact and engage. Now, in communications, we do a little bit different from what you guys do in journalism. Our bent is to create communications that are meant to inform also, but also persuade and evoke. So one of the things that we do in this class is we look at the popular culture as one of the lenses, and we examine cultural texts to help give us some perspective and understand really what culture is. We look at the power of the U.S. and how important all of our cultural artifacts and texts are and the global impact that they have. We also look at the actual cultural industries that we call, so advertising industries and other communications industries, and what they do with these cultural products. And it's really the commoditization of that. So what does this all have to do with it? Well, when people look at us, they're looking through the vein of the kind of cultural products that we present. So you might even have some examples, like we have here, of migrants perceiving that this is really how we are, all of us in this country. Now, I know that many of you probably don't feel that this accurately reflects you as a person, as a culture. So again, the study and the examples that we give have given rise to what we call this cultural imperialism. Now, why am I talking about all of this? Because the dominance of our culture is something that we need to examine in, obviously, a global society. So one of the things we also do is then talk about ourselves. And we can't really have effective communications with others until we understand sort of where we fit in the puzzle. And so there's a lot of examination of the different cultural identities that we are avowed to, and also the ones that are ascribed to us. So what we do for the second part of it is understand how prejudice and stereotype evolves culturally, and also what we do with our own identity and the many facets that make us who we are. And then from that place, we can then start to have more meaningful, conscious, ethical communications with others. And obviously, you can see, hopefully, the importance of that in the communications industry job. So when we talk about identity, one of the things, we do two main projects. And the first project is a scholarly research paper that looks at a cultural issue and then recommends communications sort of solution for that, that is sensitive and ethical. The other thing that we look at is our own identity. And the projects and the in-class exercises that we do throughout are hoping to evolve someone's understanding of their own identity. And so what this gives rise to is what we call an identity mosaic, which is a digital story that's part of the second part of the final for everyone in the class. And so I'd like to bring up Mandy to talk about her experience creating this digital story. And
I was a graphic design major before I was communications. project, it really helped me go through all my different identities, and I think that's really important because we don't just identify ourselves with just race, but also like where we come from, where we grew up in, who the people we surround ourselves with. So this was a really good project to do, and I try to put as much of my graphic design experience in it so people knew where I came from before I became in a communications major. And what else should I
talk about? I think it's fantastic. Yeah, I think we jump into your story.
Light. Hello, my name is Mandy Fong, or Fong Man Yi. Man Yi is my Chinese name, and it is not a translation of my English name. Fong means the way of, direction, or square. Man means graceful, and Yi means definition or meaning. I hail from Brooklyn, New York City. Here I learned English and American Sign Language. My father grew up in Hong Kong, but was born in Huaipei, which is where my mother was born and raised. At home, I speak two dialects of Cantonese, Huaipei and Guangzhouhua. New Year's Day is coming soon, and I know everyone is ready for this year to end. I know I'm excited. I don't party, though, but my family and I just watch TV until midnight for the New Year countdown. But New Year's Day is another year of life for me. Sometimes, after or before my Gregorian birthday, I celebrate my lunar birthday, which lands on the 12th lunar month and the 9th day. After that, I look forward to another New Year celebration, the Lunar Year. According to the Chinese zodiac, I was born the year of the monkey. The Lunar New Year is great. I get to visit some family and friends to give them offerings and wish them good fortune. What's better than that? The unmarried and children get red envelopes with money inside. Just kidding. That's not the only best thing about Lunar New Year. It's one of the most festive Chinese holidays besides the Mid-Autumn Festival, and food is great at this time of year. I love to draw and do origami. I'm addicted to doing anything arts and crafts. That includes crocheting, jewelry making, and anything DIY. My heart belongs in Hong Kong, where the Umbrella Movement protest takes place. This protest started in September in hopes of universal suffrage and promote democracy in Hong Kong. That being said, I'm pro-democracy, and I'm a feminist. I believe in fighting for equality for both women and men. As a Chinese American female, I feel that it is important to be educated on issues of racism and sexism. I have a wide range of tastes. I love American, Mexican, Dominican, Vietnamese, Indian, Chinese, and Italian food. But it's not limited to that. In America, they have burgers and Chinese takeout. Did you know Chinese takeout is not authentic Chinese food? In America, they use ingredients that they do not cook in actual Chinese cuisine. One ingredient being broccoli. Quesadillas are amazing, and I've only had mofongo once, but it tastes incredible. Pho is a great Vietnamese dish to try, and it's got this homewarming feeling because the broth takes 6 hours to make. The masala chicken has been my latest craving, especially with naan. Italian cuisine has about everything delicious. Pasta and bruschetta is my go-to dish. Finally, we have Chinese food, exclusively Cantonese food. Here we have a photo of a crock pot setup. Hot pot is almost similar to Korean barbecue, but instead of a grill, everything is boiled in the center of the table. My taste in music, much like food, has a wide palette. Here are some examples of songs I listen to. Kendrick Lamar is one of my favorite hip-hop artists. I love Frank Ocean's R&B songs, especially because they're kind of catchy and he has a really good voice. Sound is more different from the other two because his songs are only instrumental and it has an ambient feel to it. Little Dragon is electronic like Tycho, but they're mixed with indie rock and funk. Finally, we have Gorillaz, which ties in all my tastes together because they're mixed with hip hop and alternative rock. To end this video, I wanted to say that the values exercise really opened my eyes on what I should focus on. currently teach at an origami studio and attend special corporate events with the studio. I hope to apply the knowledge from this class with these new experiences and also apply these experiences to my future as an event planner.
As you can see, that's not a small feat, and it really pulls together, I think, the thrust of what we try to do with intercultural communication is really understand that identity. But there are a lot of things there that also have to come together. Obviously, there was a script that needed to be written. There was a storyboard that needed to be created. And then it all had to be assembled with music and design. So a tremendous amount of work, and I think that everybody would agree that it's you know, there's a moderate amount of work in the class, but it all I think helps people understand the context of which we take some of the other courses as well. So the second class I'd like to share with you is Creative Advertising, and it's a media course. And one of the things that we do in Creative Advertising is really understand our context of, obviously, of communications. But we look at all of the different motivations that we would have in informing, persuading, promoting, and motivating people. Again, like I said, very different from journalism. We're here to persuade, and we're here to create brand stories. And so when we look at ads, we don't just look at them for what they are. We're trying to deconstruct what makes them good, bad, or otherwise. And so some of the students do analyses of those, and we go through a number of different assignments that help arrive at the different reasons and facets why someone might respond to an ad. And there are a lot of different levers for people. It could be emotionally resonant, maybe it's persuasive, maybe it's appropriate to the brand, or maybe visually it just kind of captures you, or does it sell that product or advance an agenda well? So we really deconstruct what makes ads work and what makes them not work. And so one of the things that we look at is not just what makes them work visually, because we have to talk about design and we have to talk about all of the traditional elements of advertising, and we break those apart. We also have to look at what happens when it doesn't work. And one of the things that Brandon did was take an example of a bad ad and make it better.
As you can see here, this burger doesn't even look good. And I don't know where to start. If I'm driving by on the highway trying to see what type of brand this is, where to go to get this burger, I wouldn't even know where to go. The numbers, everything is way too close together. The amount of space and everything is all jumped together. It's all mumbo jumbo. Between the font, the colors are way too similar. There's no contrast. There's no spacing. As far as channeling that message, they didn't really do it very effectively compared to this. As you can see here, that burger looks a lot better, ultimately. And start off with the brand title, Burger Fresh, the subtitle, breakfast, lunch, dinner, the product, and where to go right after. And ultimately, this here is an example of a symmetrical design. If you were to fold this in half, the exact product, everything is in full alignment, everything is organized properly, and the spacing is very well for that correct message. So, yes.
Well done, Brandon. Thank you. Two things about Brandon's. Number one, when he started that class, he didn't know Photoshop. So he taught himself Photoshop for this class. He doesn't have Mandy's design background, yet he really rose to the challenge to create something that was as visually compelling as an ad like this. And also, I want to thank you for using all of those buzzwords. We didn't even coach him on that, but it was a while ago, and he remembers all of the lingo that we use. So, obviously, making it look good is one thing, but making it be appropriate is another thing altogether. And so, one of the things that we also look at is sort of breaking apart what the ingredients are needed to make an ad. Because, again, we're intending to persuade someone to do, think, or act something. So there has to be a sound strategy, there has to be an idea, some sort of benefit and support. And another assignment that we do is to try to pull all of those things together and make sure that it answers those questions as well. So not only do you have to do the design, but you actually have to put it together. One of the challenges that I had tasked the students with was introducing this new line of dark chocolate for Hershey's as a low-cost, healthy way to enjoy and health benefits, and really try to educate them about the health benefits of dark chocolate. So there were a lot of objectives inside of that it had to be healthy, anybody pipe in, right? It had to be low cost, And a lot of folks were having a challenge with that. So this was an example in not just design, but also copywriting. And I think what we've got here is some really great examples. I'm going to read through this for both of you. Square Day can keep the doctor away. Extra special, extra healthy. Fantastic subhead, right? Who knew that you could prevent skin wrinkles, lower your blood pressure, and increase blood flow to your heart with just a bite? Miracle in a bag, pretty much. That's a fantastic body copy. So not only is it looking good, but it also is answering some really critical brand problems. Any client would say that they've done that assignment correctly. Here's Mandy's example. Special Dark, two kisses, a lot to give. Can you feel the light? Hershey's Special Dark chocolate kisses are delicious. Wait, I'm going to read from here, sorry. Delicious without the guilt. It will help with preventing heart disease and powering, it will improve, can I read it from here? That's probably better. Sorry. It will help from preventing heart disease and protecting your skin against the sun. It will improve brain function as well. Special Dark kisses have a natural source of cocoa, flavanol antioxidants, which promotes better cardiovascular health and better blood flow. Not to mention, dark chocolate also helps with weight loss and reducing stress. All that with only two kisses. Now that's affordable. So really some great examples of solving important brand problems, but also doing it in a way that was design appropriate. So I want to commend the students for really coming along with that. And then the final project was a challenge that was to bring it all together in what we call the big brainstorm, where they then took the design, they also took their understanding of a brand, and invented a new product. So I challenged the students, and Brandon's going to take you through it, with creating what we call a 360 campaign. And what that is looking at all the multiple ways that we can project a message. But first, they had to invent a product. And in the mass that we have today, all of these energy drinks and things like that, why don't we create a drink that helps people relax and puts them to sleep or helps them just sort of chill out? So they had to invent it, strategically position it in the market. So they had to do that and then identify the visual identity system that would pull it through, and then various executions or different examples of that. So again, I'm going to hand it off to Brandon to take you through what he did for it.
How are you guys doing? So before anything, it's very important to plan and properly execute on how you're going to make your presentation to channel that message, just like Parada did with his research and reporting and knowing exactly what it is you're doing prior to actually executing that plan. So here, I decided to do blue tea. Many people here know green tea, which sounds a lot more attractive than blue tea. So I went the whole opposite route. But what I did was I went with a product that's probably most likely going to be in demand due to the fact that we live in a chemically dependent, drug-oriented society. Today, nowadays, everybody tends to rely on medicine, rely on drugs, over-the-counter things to really just go about their day and feel better whenever it is they don't feel well. So I went with something that's going to sell whether or not I try to or not. It's probably going to sell on its own. So here you have to have your big idea and your theme of trying to make this medicinal product that's going to be therapeutically made for any individual so they can get the best rest they can get without having to go to the pharmacy to spend money. And here, basically the visual branding system, the whole outline of exactly how I'm going to use all of my media outlets starts with typography. Font happens to be very important in advertising nowadays. The way you use your font and lettering is very significant on that overall brand. Color palette, everything's very complementary with one another. You see I use blue for blue tea. There's a lighter blue, a darker blue, and yellow. Very similar colors and a lot of colors that would work well hand in hand for a proper image. Iconography is exactly what type of pictures I'm going to use during that message. The tea, blueberries, caution sign, it's the sleep mode, and here's an example of exactly how the tea looks on a cup. So here's an example of the web page. More than just exactly trying to market the product, I really tried to make it a very welcoming experience for many users, so when they go on that page, they can feel welcomed at home and just try to experience the product more for what it is than just me trying to show them as like a sale, as like a sales pitch. So, and here is an example of ambient outdoor marketing. We live in a very technologically advanced society, so what I really tried to do was bring it out of the whole social media campaign, the whole online experience, and try to make it more personal. It's very important to learn how to personalize a brand and personalize a product to try to lure in an audience for a long-term business transaction and continuity. So as you can see here, I don't know that hotel. It was I don't remember all those shows back in the day. Rapunzel with the hair. I tried doing something like that. Yeah. And here's Blue Tea, the whole application I use. Another very warming, cordial experience I tried to make for all the users. And here's an example of a print ad. A lot of the whole journalism stuff. Yeah. Can't sleep. Blue Tea is the fast way to help you sleep. You have the headline, the subhead, the product, and exactly how you can reach us. So, yeah.
So, that's basically all I have to say about our two classes, but I really want to thank you both for not only presenting your work, but also retaining everything that we talked about and showing everybody what we do. So, thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Snyder. Thank you, students. I feel gratified, vindicated. It's when I was studying television video back in the early 80s. People would look and say, television video? I don't want to go to Hollywood. I don't want to do that kind of work. Why? It's for television. But you see from multimedia presentations, Mindy's presentation, you know, Brian's presentation, right? They're all video and audio is very embedded in our daily lives. You go on your phone, you look at video, you go to a website. And so you need to understand how to write. You need to understand how to tell a story, how to light, how to record the story, how to edit the story, because the narrative, the elements that make up the story, are the most important things. Convincing people of what you're saying is true, or vindicating, or being present. Up next, we're going to introduce Professor Steve DeRosa. Steve teaches in the film studies program. The major now consists of, you know, radio and television journalism, but also film studies. Film studies, they don't produce films, but they produce scripts. They produce really concepts in comparing directors and styles of films from history and now in the present and what's happening in the future. So please welcome Professor Steve DeRosa.
A little bit about the course called Masters of Film, which is one of the foundation courses in the film and culture concentration. Before I go there, though, I wanted to, and Theo Karanikolis is going to actually speak specifically to the class itself, three filmmakers who are kind of foundations, I think, of any solid film studies program, D.W. Griffith, Orson Welles, and Alfred Hitchcock. Before I go there, I want to kind of echo what Professor Perotta said earlier about being well-rounded and having to have the ability to really, you know, be mobile and to be open to other areas in the media studies major, because you never know. You might, as he said, you might have designs on one specific area, being behind the camera or being a journalist, being a reporter, being whether it might be a movie critic, a screenwriter, and so forth. There's so many different fields and so many different avenues. And so you might wonder, what are you going to do with this degree? And I can tell you from my own personal experience, my career path has never been dull, and I thank that to my media studies and my film studies education. This is an exciting time, I think, particularly in film and culture major specifically. I think it's just taking into account of what access students have to films that, going back to when I was a graduate student and undergrad, it was sometimes very difficult and very challenging to have access to films by certain directors, even directors such as these three pillars, to actually get to see their films and study their films closely. You sometimes had to wait for either being registered in the film studies course or wait for the occasional retrospective at a revival house, such as a film forum or a Museum of Modern Art or Museum of the Moving Image and such. And now today, with Blu-ray, Criterion Collection, Netflix, most of these great films that are worthy of serious study are a click away. So now you can do repeat viewings on films, frame-by-frame analysis to really get a close look at these films. And again, films, it's a reflection of our culture and vice versa, so it's very important to be able to have that look and to look closely at movies. in terms of my own career path as an author, a film historian, I've had great experiences with going through studio archives, getting to interview writers, directors, producers, some movie stars as well. I've been in documentaries with the likes of Martin Scorsese, Guillermo del Toro, and Curtis Hanson. I've had the occasion to write for the Writers Guild of America Awards. But then I've also worked on the post-production side of the business, cutting movie trailers, syncing dailies, when we actually used to sync dailies on film. So it's kind of completely moved away from actually touching film any longer than digital production and post-production. On the PR side, you have to be open to that as well. Right? On the PR side, I've been a media liaison for companies such as JVC Professional. Our TV production studio has JVC Professional cameras, so those cameras come from a company that I was representing toward the media. And I even helped to sue Steven Spielberg, but that's another story. So you have to be open and be available to anything that your career path may take you in this major. So explore, take other courses outside of your specific concentration. That's very important. I'm going to turn it over to Theo Karanikolas, who's going to talk about Orson Welles, and I think we're going to talk about how he broke some Hollywood conventions and why that's important.
So, excuse me, public speaking is not one of my best subjects, and there's nowhere to hide up here. All right, so hello, everyone. My name is Theo Karanikolas. I'm a media studies major with a focus on film, and I'm currently taking Masters of Film with Professor Roman. In Masters of Film, we look at the bodies of work of three influential directors, D.W. Griffith, Orson Welles, and Alfred Hitchcock. Not only do we analyze the styles of these directors, but also the effects of the time periods and the effects of the culture on these bodies of work. Three directors in particular are widely renowned and respected in film. So we discuss their film works and how they're relevant today, and if they're relevant today. For example, the career of Orson Welles is both marred by difficulties and personal strife, but also incredible works of film. Through his unique style, Welles was also able to create films such as Citizen Kane and The Magnificent Ambersons, which to this day remain visually and emotionally striking. Welles uses lighting, elaborate sets, dramatic editing, and innovative camera angles masterfully. In Citizen Kane, Welles uses chiaroscuro lighting to set the tone of the scene. Through his directing, the lighting becomes a catalyst which emphasizes the character's feelings. In the opening scene, the harsh contrast of the lighting creates a sense of isolation and despair. The set piece of Xanadu, as you can see here, serves not just to inspire awe and grandeur, but also creates a mood which is uninviting and frightening. Welles broke away from the traditional Hollywood style, taking risks and using non-conventional storylines. The fact that the story effectively starts at the end of Kane's life is a creative choice which Welles had to fight for. Furthermore, the fact that there is no dialogue for the first 2.5 minutes of the film is another creative choice. The one word, which some of you probably know, Rosebud, is the hook which draws the audience into the mystery of the life of Charles Foster Kane. Don't ruin it, Kane. In the span of one scene, Welles manages to hook the audience, create an emotional response, and highlight the complicated life of a man, and all in about 3 minutes. This is why Orson Welles is a master of film and deserves to still be studied today. Thank you. So it's the beginning scene. It's the first couple minutes, and I'll talk more about it after this.
Yeah, you'll notice all the different imagery, which is what you're going to speak to. It sums up the character of Charles Foster Kane, as Theo said, and there's only one line of dialogue in the whole sequence.
So as you can see, there's all these pictures and images of this like big expensive place, the monkeys. First, like, oh, monkeys, that's pretty cool. But then they're in this like really creepy place, and there's something off about it. There's also the light in the window that through all the cuts. He keeps getting closer and closer to it, and then right when you get to the front of the window, the light goes out, signifying the passing of his life. And it's just, I don't know, it's Citizen Kane's one of my favorite movies, and there's a lot of really cool stuff, and you can watch that once and just see it as like the first 3 minutes of the movie, but if you take the time to analyze it, there's just so much more, so much underneath it, and I think that's why it works so well, it's so great.
Alright, thank you, Professor DeRosa. What I love about watching film, even old films, it gives you a slice of perspective, you know, from that time period, and an idea from the director, and a whole crew of people that are working towards creating that idea. Any idea that may not necessarily be accurate, but it's an idea. That's all it is, really. It's a thought process. And it's much like going to a museum and looking at a picture on the wall. You see a picture on the wall painted by an artist like 200 years ago, and you look at the idea that the artist was trying to put forward. How did society influence that artist? And I think films, you know, do that wonderfully in the 20th and 20th, now in the 21st century. Anyway, moving along, writing for film and TV was taught by Professor Augustine McCarthy. Unfortunately, Professor McCarthy cannot be here. He's in Manhattan teaching. And but he endorsed a script, a student-written script, to come read for us at the showcase. And the readers are right here. Sherry Lewis, written by Sherry Lewis, and the readers are right here. And please come up front and read your script or read a scene from your script. And I believe in Professor McCarthy, so I haven't heard the script, the scene anyway. And so I hope it's exciting, I'm quite sure. It's all yours.
Okay, so my script is about two friends named Khalil and Nikki. And Khalil basically finds out that he has cancer, so he decides to make a bucket list, which I know is already a film, but I didn't know that until now. So they go on this journey together, and in the end, their friendship, it becomes closer, and eventually she falls in love with him. Here's the beginning. End of the script.
Okay, The Bucket List by Sherry Lewis. Interior, Brighton Wells Middle School Day. Nikki, 13 years old, immaculate, preppy, is hugging her books in front of her chest as she walks through her class. She shyly glances around the hall with the doors. Room 110, room 111, room 112. She stops at room 112 and brushes her skirt with her hand, which dangle of three bracelets, each different charms. She pushes her shoulder-length bob-cut hair behind her ears as she pulls the door open. Inside of the classroom, are rowdy kids sitting on desks, laughing and joking with one another. The teacher is sitting behind the desk, unbothered,
and who are you? Oh, hi, I'm Nikki. I'm him.
The kids make ooh noises as they hear one whistling. Khalil looks up from his comic book, leaning back in his chair. His feet laid on the desk. He's wearing all black, a leather jacket, black combat boots, and a black beanie.
Fresh meat.
Nikki bashfully glances at the kid. Her cheeks flush a rosy pink. They make complete eye contact. Classroom is painted in horrible old yellow. The chalkboard says, "Welcome back, 8th graders." The smiley face under it, and he giggles at the sight.
Did you cannot see, right there.
She points to an empty desk by the window.
I will be right back. I have to go to the front office. While I'm gone, everyone please, hey Donald, stop pulling our weird ass hair. What is wrong with you?
The teacher sucks her teeth as she leaves the classroom. Nikki sits politely at the empty desk and takes out a fresh and distinct envelope. It was black and silver glitter, says Nikki Rose on the cover. She takes out her pink push-up pen with pink leopard fur on the top. Khalil drags his feet off the desk as he walks over to Nikki. He flops down on the edge of her desk and grins.
Hey, what's up, Khalil?
He leans back and gives Nikki full eye contact as she's reading her, which makes her squirm in her seat.
I'm Nikki.
Yeah, her sweet fresh feet, huh? I'll give you his order.
Nikki's eyebrows raise in confusion as Khalil takes Nikki by her hand and walks her over to the front of the classroom.
Well, this is Ms. Fuller's desk. Why is your ex calling Ms. Fuller? You saw that coming.
He grabs her purse from under the desk and places it on the desk.
And here, Ms. Brewer's lady's crap. And now look, $20.
He hands it over to me.
For you, my lady.
No thanks. I don't steal.
Well, you could just hold it for me. I just got some issues.
Khalil walks over to the desk in front of Ms. Bullard's desk with his back towards Nikki. He pretends to tie his shoe as he smirks and gives a quick wink to his friends in the back of the classroom. Suddenly, Ms. Bogard returns car dashes over to Nikki and snatches the money out of her hand. She grabs Nikki by the shoulder as part of her sweater.
Attention for one place.
Exterior Brighton Wells Middle School parking lot. Day. Nikki nearly walks out of the detention hall and towards the bus stop. She sighs as she rubs her eyes. Khalil comes walking from around the corner. He notices Nikki and runs over to her. She frowns and turns her back as she begins to walk the opposite side of the sidewalk.
Hey, what up?
Khalil finally catches up to her out of breath. He stops her in her tracks as he catches his breath.
Look, I'm sorry. It's just a little joint plant fresh meat. You, though, were being full on.
Leave me alone.
Look, Nikki. Nicole.
It's Nikki.
Okay, Nikki. I'm really, really sorry.
Nikki exhales and rolls her eyes in her feet.
Okay, fine. I accept your apology. That detention was the worst. The teacher snored the whole time. So thank you very, very much.
Let me make it up to you, please. Trust me. I know how Mr. Howard snores on.
They laugh. Nikki shyly brushes her elbow and pushes her hair behind her ear.
So, I'm thinking. Pizza? Mommy?
Nikki squints at her little smiles.
Fine. Pizza does sound good right about now.
Cool.
Khalil flashes her a bright smile as they walk side by side towards the bus stop. It's off to interior pizza shop, present day. At this point, we see an early 20-year-old Khalil and Nikki sitting across from each other in their usual pizza.
Okay, so I have some exciting news.
Khalil looks daunted. He's wearing a leather jacket and his cigarette in his ear. He puts his head between his hands and exhales harshly.
Yes, news too.
And as my best friend, I decided you're the first to know.
Nikki inhales.
Okay, so on a count of three, we say it at the same time. Ready? One.
Two.
Three. I'm moving to Cali.
Nikki pauses. Khalil puts his head on his hand and lets out a huge sigh. Nikki is frozen. Her mouth is slightly open in disbelief. She doesn't move. She just stares at Khalil from across the table. They stay there for a while, quiet. Khalil picks his head up and puts his cap on backwards. He lets out another sigh and looks at Nikki with his hazel eyes paired with a teardrop tattoo under his arm.
I went in for an exam today. They found a tumor. It's treatable, they said. It's something to stress about. I know you get about these kind of things.
God, Akil. Khalil. That I don't care about anything act really isn't going to help the situation right now.
I know.
Khalil reaches over the table and grabs Nikki's hand. It looks so tiny and delicate in comparison to his. He's rough looking and he has black pink onion tails. Nikki's shoulders collapse as she squeezes his hand.
So what are you gonna do?
Oh, we have to help Naja.
Of course.
Nikki looks at Khalil with concerning eyes. She blinks away her tears.
I also have another thing in mind.
Khalil puts out a blue notebook and opens it to the first page. On the page says bucket list. Nikki's lips curl downward at this sight.
I have two things I want to do. I'm not saying I'm gonna die.
He pauses.
I mean, it's just something to keep me from feeling like shit mentally, you know?
I guess so. Can I see it?
No, you may not. You're doing all of this with me. I want one to be quiet. I mean, it is you want to go on vacation, right? We're here. You need you and this list of outrageous things to do.
Nikki looks uneasy. She's still frowning and her eyes come between Khalil and the book. She knows that she has to be strong for Khalil. She lets out and speaks inside.
Fine.
Khalil jumps up and hugs her best friend from across the table, kisses her forehead over and over, and flashes her a smile.
It'll be fine. You won't regret it. I promise.
Khalil holds Nikki in his arms tightly as he gently brushes the back of her pink sweater. He rests her chin on his shoulders and hugs her back as a tear falls from her eye.
Thank you, Sherry. And special thanks to Janae Parker, who just stepped in the last minute to read lines because she didn't know until this morning that we needed a fourth reader. But I thought, you know, the script, you know, it was pretty interesting. It's this level one writing class at Writing for the TV, and there'll be a level two as well. So I'm quite sure that idea can be honed down and will be honed and reworked into something even more polished. Up next, we have video editing, riveted montage. Professor John Savage teaches courses in radio production, video editing, level one, level two, teaches understanding media technology. He also assists in the TV studio with updating the technology, wiring, etc. Please welcome Professor John Savage.
So I have this pen, and most of you know how to hold one. I could probably go through this and teach you how to fold it properly, left hand, right hand, and how to make swirls and lines that look like and ultimately become words. But just because you know how to use a pen, what makes you think you're a great author or a poet? Well, somehow that logic breaks when you learn a program and you think you know how to edit because you know Final Cut or you know Premiere or you know some other tool. Important to know. You have to know your tools. But I teach you what to do in this business. When you learn to drive a car, if you drive a car, you don't learn how to drive a Honda Civic. You learn how to drive. The rules of the road are the same. Between vehicle to vehicle, the equipment may change. Yeah, you have to maybe learn how to drive stick. So the approach that I always take is to learn what to do with it. Know what's going to happen before you even sit down. Get past the equipment and focus on what you need to do. Because it's going to change. You'll develop your own style. You're just like with the pen, you'll develop your own writing style. You'll develop even your own form of art. But you're doing it in a much different medium. And as you can see, everything we've seen today, it's been edited. And it's come down to somebody sitting down, looking at something, and reimagining it, re-envisioning it. Now, ironically enough, the one thing I'm going to show today is one of the few projects that I do at this level that actually kind of gives total creativity back to the editor. And at that point, that person's really more of a filmmaker. So the technique, this particular technique, there's different phrases for it, but I'm just going to keep it simple. It's cutting to music. All right, and there's different techniques and different theories of what that's called. But out of this semester, it's tough. Sometimes semester's very easy. There's not much to choose from. Hate to say it. This was a little difficult because there was a lot of good stuff to choose from. All right. But it really came down to one, and short, sweet, it's to the point, and it still makes some suggestions to it. But I don't have to give it any setup. All right, so if you're ready. This is by Elena Almeida. It's going to probably start with the slate, which is just some technical stuff we do. stickler for deadlines and time restraints and meeting those types of things, so I'm not going to take too much longer. I'll try to keep within what you ask me to do. But once again, totally conceived and purposely use stills. And most of the stuff that we cut has sound and has motion, but this was also to kind of shake things up a little bit and show that you can tell a story. Short, sweet, to the point. Convey a message. And you don't have to clobber anybody over the head. And again, a few years from now, Elena may look at this and know all the things she could have done to actually improve it. I'll leave you on this one thing, and I won't bore you with the whole story. Take my class and I'll bore you with the story. I was editing for almost 15 years before I actually felt comfortable in my skin to call myself an editor. So it's not a person, don't take it personally when somebody comes to me and says, oh, I know how to edit, and I kind of roll my eyes at you. It's just, it's its own form of art. And some people see it as very utilitarian, you know, just the director made the image, the director's telling the story, you just assemble it. And yet, let an editor take that footage, it'll be more magnificent than what that director could have seen in his own head. And they could have written it. So I'll just leave you on that, and that's it.
All right, thank you. I'm going to show you a few things. One thing we've done in the TV studio last semester, it's not editing at all. It's all alive. It's produced live. It's directed live. All the workers, the audio person, camera people, the floor manager, everyone is there working in concert with each other to put on this narrative. The students tend to like to write comedy, so I let them write comedy. But keep in mind, there's no editing involved. Not this one, the other one. There's no editing involved with this at all. You should show the other one. No, after it's on. That's actually behind the scenes, but I want you to see the video first. And then you can see what went on behind the scenes, because when you watch a video, you tend to be absorbed in the performance and, you know, the color, the light and sound, what's happening. But with this program focusing on television production, it's really what's happening behind the scenes to promote something like this together. So with no further ado, play this video real quick at the light speed. Showing what's going on in the execution of that scene in the actual studio. And we have a director right there, Jacqueline. She's not here today. She graduated. But her sister is here, Chloe. Say hi, Chloe. And Daniel's next to her, technical directing, selecting the shots that go on to the screen that you're going to be watching. To the left of Jacqueline is Chris, is the assistant director that's lining up the cameras. And right now we have the audio person that's cueing in the sound effects and also mixing the audio that's happening live in the control room. And you can see on the multi-image display panel, you know, the choices she has to select, and up at the top are the actual is the actual shot that's being shown in the final piece. So you see, it's more like a concert, a play of the people in front of the camera are acting, performing, the people behind the camera in the control room are acting and performing just as intensely to capture everything that's happening in front of the camera. And so that's multi-camera studio production. That's level three, where students write and produce their own scenes. In level two, I hand them scripts so they have an idea of what it looks like. And in level one, they learn the actual parameters of the studio, how to do that work, how to run the cameras, how to be a technical director, how to be a director, how to be a floor manager, an audio person, et cetera, and so on. So that's, you know, television production, multi-camera television production, which is very different in the sense of what John Misevich just showed you. Even with the other projects you saw today, where they were very edited. They were redirected in the editing stage. You could sit there and think about it, cut in a shot, go to sleep, wake up, change the shot, and then go to presentation. This is something that's live multi-camera is being produced while it's happening. Shows that are done this way are like portions of situation comedies, but talk shows are done this way, game shows are done this way, award shows are done this way, sports are done this way. So there's something to be said about spontaneous directing. It's not 100% spontaneous. You have to know a little bit about how to plan and what's going to happen next. And then you have to go through a lot of rehearsals. That might have been take 7 or take, you remember, Faith? What take that was, the last
one? That was take 5.
Take 5. Okay, so at least 5 takes after it was rehearsed several times before we started recording. So it takes, you know, several hours to do something like that. All right, so just Faith, one of the performers is right here. Brandon. I said Brandon really is not adopted.
The other actor is actually in class, another class.
I got one more clip to show you. We have an independent project, an independent study, by Kareem Fisher, who's running camera back there. And Kareem gathered a few people together to help out, about 5 media studies students to help out with him. But this also highlights the music technology program and the performance of the music technology program. So every Friday night or for the last several months. What? Shanae, you want to talk about it? Kareem's not going to talk about it. Okay, so Kareem has elected Shanae to talk about this project. So this is an independent project that they use the TV studio. Incidentally, this is the first thing we shot on high definition with the new cameras. Everything we've seen so far is in standard definition. So this, you know, should look a lot better. Kareem spent a lot of time with other students, and Shanae included, and Diana, and Lauren Ostumi, and Juan from Music Tech back there. A lot designing the set, doing lighting, doing rehearsals on Wednesday night and Thursday night, and then actually shooting on Friday night until 11 o'clock at night. I would text them and said, did you lock up the studio yet? And 12 o'clock, and text me back. I'm finished, Grasso. We locked up. It's all safe. So Janae Parker worked closely with Kareem. She's going to speak for Kareem in terms of introducing what you're going to see. Thank you, Juan, for saying that.
Hi, everybody. So he kind of mentioned what we do. Me and Kareem this year have started a club called MD8, which stands for Immersive Digital Aids. So we basically took 8 different media outlets, everything from graphic design to audio engineering to TV and radio production, and created a club where we can all come together and all of our different ideas and put together and create something really awesome. Kareem came to me like on a random last year and was like, how come nobody does anything with the studio besides classes? And I was like, you're right. So we started this club, and we've been doing recording live acoustic sessions since like the second week of school this year, I want to say. Juan back there has been really big help from the MTech program. Yeah, thank you. We just had a show, a concert called Mix and Bars Live last week. We did 2 different segments. One was an acoustic segment with 4 artists, and then a hip-hop and rap section. So what you're going to see is footage from all the videos we've been doing. We did interviews during the concert. I'm behind the camera, so Kareem was directing the whole thing. And it's just been hours and weeks of work and planning, and it's been a lot of fun. And the club is open to anybody who wants to join. So if you see the flyers, you know, shoot an email. So you're going to see that recap. So
acoustic kind of alternative.
As an active independent artist, you kind of have to take your career into your own hands.
She's doing Elena Almeida is directing a directional concept. We're waiting for Gidget. Okay, I promise you have the floor. I would not give you the floor again.
So my group and I were assigned a project, and we decided to create directional concepts for the play Waiting for Bordeaux by the playwright Samuel Beckett. The play itself is about these two men, one named Vladimir, the other one named Estragon, and they're waiting for a person or being named Bordeaux. However, we decided to create a new central idea where these characters were not old men, but instead unproductive college students from Oxford University. We wanted college students because the play itself gave the idea of life is mysterious and it's a difficult path, and like college students, we're trying to find ourselves. And we want to seek answers to life and how to figure it out, and by doing that, so we can find our moments to prosper. And it's like young adults, we are also afraid of being alone, and that's actually seen by the relationship of Vladimir and Estragon. Now then, why college students? Well, we noticed that Bordeaux had this huge sense of authority and importance with Estragon and Vladimir. And the way they had this lack of communication with him as they waited, it gave the idea of how college students or young adults, adults in general, have this difficulty of connecting with God. And it made it more relatable with young lives. And also, Estragon and Vladimir had moments where they were reckless and totally illogical. One moment being where they actually thought about hanging themselves on a tree. Fortunately, they didn't, but they were actually almost conceiving about it. Why not? And also, another reason is that they didn't know what their own needs were, such as Vladimir and Estragon not remembering exactly what they asked Bordeaux for, and that reveals a disconnect to their own personal needs. Just like us as young adults, we don't really know what we want, and we're trying to figure that out. And lastly, the fear of being alone. Estragon being dependent on Vladimir, and this was seen in a quote, "There are times when I wonder if it wouldn't be better for us to part," Estragon says. But Vladimir answers, "You wouldn't go far." So it shows that they need each other, there's some kind of relationship. And also with Hazo and Lucky, how they always travel together, and the way they travel together, I'll get into. And Hazo using Lucky at one point as a seeing eye, because in Act 2 he becomes blind. And it just shows that their relationships, that people need each other, young adults need their peers, and how when they go into the future, into their careers, sometimes they have to disconnect, lose touch, and there's a fear of that in us all. And as for the actors, I thought the director, Estragon, could be played by Keir Gilchrist, because of his dangly features, his almost sense of innocence can emphasize the dependence that Estragon emits, especially with Vladimir. And because there's a quote in the play that I caught, that I can see Estragon being an English literature undergraduate and a senior. For Vladimir, I saw the actor Robert Emms playing him. He has a tall and more assertive structure, just expresses the idea that he would be responsible for Vladimir, because he seemed like he would be the responsible one. And there are times when he quotes the Bible and tells the story of Christ and the two thieves, Therefore, I saw him being a theology major as well as a senior in college. For Pazzo, I saw Jack Raynor playing him because he presented a strong and confident figure, and in Act 1, Pazzo is very confident, arrogant even. However, his soft features emphasizes the weakness that Pazzo then shows in Act 2 when he becomes blind. And Pazzo in general, as a graduate student, he would be wealthy and preppy and have a superiority complex. However, like anyone that has money, are they truly happy? And in Act 2, Pazzo, his character in general, becomes depressed and is the most pessimistic person we probably ever meet. So right there sends another message of more money can't really make you happy. Like, money doesn't make a happy person. As for Lucky isn't so lucky. And the reason is with his relationship with Pazzo. But I imagine Sam Stripe playing him because he's thin and childlike, almost someone that would seem easily taken advantage of. And I see him as an undergraduate, a freshman, somebody new to college and who wants to assimilate. And he is trying to get into a fraternity, and I'll explain how he tries. And he is basically Pazzo's slave and seeing eye. There is eventually a boy mentioned in the play, and I imagine Marcus D'Angelo playing him. His acting skills are excellent. And he presents an innocent and easily frightened by people as a boy did in the actual play. Now, our costume designer, Lauren, she's not here today, but as for our costume designer, because Estragon gave the aura of an English major with the quote when he says, when Vladimir says to him, you should have been a poet, and Estragon then says, I was, and he gestures towards his friend and says, isn't that obvious? So, by him sort of suggesting that he was a poet, I imagined him having an I heart Shakespeare, and to show that he cares about literature, and because they're college students and they just don't probably have the best attire in the world, because they're just like one of us, he wears jeans, and at one point in the beginning of the play, he's wearing black boots. But once Act 2 comes along, he then he's missing his boots, and then he finds these brown pair of boots, and they don't understand where the old pair went. They're just basically confused and disheveled. And then he winds up stealing the brown ones. For Vladimir's costume, because these are Oxford University students, I wanted him to wear an Oxford University sweatshirt, just to inform the audience of what kind of students they are, where they're from, and because they're college students, casual, to be in jeans, and to be prepping with Converse, and at one point, Vladimir is trying to figure something out with his hat. He keeps looking into it, so the costume designer gave him a hat. And for Pazzo, because he's a wealthy and preppy student, we decided to have him wear a polo, dress shirt, plaid pants to show a sense of wealth and superiority, that it outshines the type of clothing that Lucky and Estragon and Vladimir wear. There is a point, though, where Pazzo enters with Lucky, and Lucky is in a 90-degree angle, almost crawling, and has a rope around his neck, and Pazzo is basically walking him like a dog. And he also has a whip with him. And in Act 2, though, when Pazzo becomes blind, he would then be wearing sunglasses. As for the farm boy, he would just be wearing something basic, plaid shirt, jeans, just give the essence that he is just a worker and nothing else. And for Lucky's outfit, because of him being a freshman wanting to assimilate into college, he would want to join a fraternity. However, as one of the pranks, he would have to wear a ridiculous suit and a ridiculous hat, and it further emphasized the irony of Lucky's lack of freedom by the suit having clouds on it, and then imagine him having a rope around his neck, which would further emphasize the sense of being trapped. And he would be carrying Louis Vuitton suitcases because those would belong to Pazzo, and it would further show Pazzo's sense of wealth. And for the stage design, this was done by Adam. He decided to do an arena stage, which is brilliant because it shows the sense of how the characters are trapped by Bordeaux, waiting for him. It's an endless time passing by the arena, being infinite, completely around, nothing's getting out almost. And the scene would be a quiet and far away distance from the campus where Estragon and Vladimir would be waiting for Godot, and of course there is the dead tree where they almost decide to hang themselves.
Thank you. Thank you very much. A lot of work that goes into the thought of the concept, the ideas of the characters, so the home audience is able to understand, the viewing audience is able to understand just by the person's appearance, what the background is and what their intentions are. I think it's a really well done. That's it, really. We've kind of wrapped up a little bit early, but I want to thank you all. But first, I want to thank Lauren Waldina. Where is she, Lauren? For running AV. I'd like to thank the presenters, not the student presenters, yet the faculty that participate in this. Then I want to thank the student presenters and the students in general, because without you guys, really, there's no point in any of this. It's your ideas which come in and you can try to help develop. It's your interactions that we help develop to get on to the very next level, which would be professional career at some point. There's more food. Please enjoy. And we have a room for another 45 minutes. So thank you very much, and have a good rest of the semester.